Hello, welcome back students. We'll now talk about chapter 3. Today we are going to discuss chapter 3. At the end of chapter 2, we discussed about the topics which will be covered in chapter 3. The name of the chapter is Industrial Environment. And we are going to discuss about role of industry in Indian economic development, challenges to Indian industry, industrial policy resolution 1991, what will be the meaning of the terms liberalization, privatization, globalization, what is the meaning of MSME, that is micro, small and medium enterprises, what are the recent trends in Indian industry. All of these things is what we are going to discuss today in detail. So welcome back. We'll start with role of industry in Indian economic development. Now Indian economy is huge, and there are many industries contributing to the development. How does industry contribute in Indian economic development? Now if you look at industries, we have something called as employment opportunities, because industries are dependent on machines and humans both. There is an opportunity to have a lot of employment. So because of industries, we see a lot of growth in jobs. This is a major role of the industry. So Indian economy is dependent on industry to provide employment to the people. This is the only industry, this is the only area, this is the only opportunity where we get to use a lot of capital, which means machines, capital is machine, capital is investment, and we are using capital with the help of industry. We also use foreign trade. A lot of transactions are possible only if there is someone from the industry who is dealing with organizations outside of India, creating an environment of buying and selling, importing and exporting. Only industry has that ability to take advantage of foreign revenues and foreign opportunities. Industry, existence of industry will help agricultural sector, as we studied in the previous chapter also, that agricultural produce or the crops that are produced in agriculture are further used in industry. So if industry is growing, that means agriculture is equally growing. Then along with agriculture, even industry has a lot of contribution in the national income of our country, in the per capita income of our country. So huge contribution by the industry also, that there is a requirement of lot of manufactured material, produced material, produced goods and services. So there's a lot of produce that is happening, and that's how it contributes to the national income. Industry follows systematic and very contemporary methods of managing business. So there is specialization in industry, there is division of labor, so there is a separate person handling a separate department. When we talk of industry, there is work distribution. Not one person has to do everything, like how we do it in agriculture. There's a singular farmer, maybe his family members are helping him. That's not how it works in industry. In industry, we divide the work, we divide the labor between all the employees that are there, and each specialist is there who will work. So that's how industry brings this new way of dealing with things and new way of managing business, that is giving specializations and dividing the labor. Industry is also useful for our defense. There's a huge requirement of defense products, tanks, machines, guns, pistols, huge requirements, bullets from the defense. And if there is any one sector which can help this defense sector, it is the industrial sector. So that's how it is extremely useful. It is a sign of higher standard of living and social change. So when you have a lot of industries in your country, it simply says that we have adapted to a higher standard of living. We want to participate in higher income. We want to live, make our standard of living different. And we want to bring this social change. So this is how industrial development or industrial role is there in the development of our economy. It improves our standard of living. It brings this expected social change. It also raises our productivity. It raises our hard-working ability. It raises our efficiency, effectiveness. And it is a leading sector to economic growth, which means if you look at Indian economic growth, role of industry would be primary, and a major contribution from industry has gone into the development of Indian economy. So if you look at how industry is important, why, what is the role of industry in Indian economic development, it is humongous, because industrial sector gives us employment, it uses our capital, it helps us to trade in the foreign lands, it improves national and per capita income, it brings new concepts of specialization and division of labor. We can use this sector into the defense. We are higher, we'll have higher standard of living, and we are accepting a social change. Our productivity increases, and finally we have an economic growth, and this is why role of industry in Indian economic development is important. So we now talk about challenges. We've been talking about challenges only throughout. There are challenges to our Indian industry also. We face certain issues when it comes to industry also. So the major, one of the major challenges is labor and employment challenges in industry. We need to fix wages. We need to fix up what kind of amounts we have to pay to the people who are working for us. And this turns out to be a major problem for our economy. We have to face unionism, which means you must be aware of trade unions, where there's a sector of employees which is headed by a singular person. They work against the organization, works against the industry to fulfill their demands. So it's a huge challenge that Indian industry faces, and it becomes extremely difficult to tackle problems related to wages or unionism. Even ensuring the security of the employees is become a problem, because when we say industry, we have huge machines, we have we could have unsafe environment, work environment, we have less lighting and illumination. So all these problems are there. We can't ensure employee security, and this turns out to be a major problem. We want our employees to work in a very safe environment, in a very cordial, happy environment, which should not affect their health by any standards. Then we also talk about social security. Socially, we need to ensure that we are taking care of our employees. We are giving them all the social advantages. Their documentation is good. They are able to get insurance from the organization. They get protection from the organization. Their salaries are protected. They get a provident fund. They get they get bonuses. They get additional perks. They get travel reimbursements or travel facilities perks. All these things ensure social security. So these are the challenges what Indian industry is facing in terms of deciding or protecting the wages of the employees, then how to stay protected from unionism, how to avoid getting into any tussles with the union, how to manage the security at the industry, then socially how to protect them. The other challenge which industry is facing is of regional imbalance. See, industry is into producing different kinds of goods and services. So it is possible that the good that is very much acceptable in a state like Maharashtra might be rejected in a state like Bihar, or a produce that is very famous in Jammu and Kashmir might not be readily accepted in a state of, let's say, Karnataka. So we can't say what kind of an imbalance is there. We need to protect that, we need to ensure that, secure that, and it's a very tough challenge for the industry. Finance, funding, industry requires a lot of money. They can't sit and just produce goods and objects without money. That's not going to happen. And in order to protect their growth, in order to protect their development, they need to find the funding, proper funding. So this turns out to be another major challenge for industry. Then there are technological issues in the industry. Nature high technology industry, need of high technology industry, economic value and technology, building internal high technology industry. So 60-70% of the industries are based on high technology. High technology is using huge, humongous, maybe a building kind structure machines, which are huge. When we use such huge machines, they come with a lot of high technology. How to use such kind of machines? These are technical issues. How to train people to use it? Is there a need of such industries? How can we show that there is some value in these in this technology? How to save cost out of this? How to take advantage of this technology? And can we build our own internal technologies? Can we build in our in-house high technology, high-tech industries? So high-tech is little difficult to control and manage. So that is why this turns out to be one of the major challenges of Indian industry. So we've seen handling labor, employment is a challenge. Regional imbalance is another challenge. Finance turns out to be a challenge. They need to secure, procure money, procure funds. And technological issues is another major challenge that our Indian industry is facing. We'll talk about industrial policy resolution in 1991 was a crucial year for our country, and we could see a lot of changes. That time our finance minister was Dr. Manmohan Singh, and he introduced a lot of changes. He introduced this policy resolution in 1991. The suggestions included contraction of public sector. Now, what public sector meant is that a lot of work was taken care by government. So what was recommended in the industrial policy resolution was that Most of the work which is taken care by public sector should be contracted. Okay, there should be de-licensing, which means anybody. There are some common industries for which there is a requirement of license. We should stop forcing people to apply for licenses. We should not make registration compulsory. Abolish registration. We must entertain foreign capital, which means allow foreigners to invest in our country, let them identify businesses, let them identify people who will be involved in taking money from them. So allow foreign people to come and invest in our country. Setting up a foreign investment promotion brand, make our country as a brand which attracts a lot of foreign investment. So we must make India as a brand, promote India as a brand, attracting foreign investment, allowing foreigners to come and invest in our company. Taking the assistance of technical experts, if whether they are from India or abroad, call them. Let them make a technical analysis, let them identify what are the technical issues and problems, and then hand it over to them. Do technical analysis, take help of technical experts. What was observed is that all government enterprises, major government public enterprises, public businesses, government businesses were making losses. And then we can't continue to survive with a loss-making organization. So hence, this was observed that, okay, we are making a lot of losses. So it has to then handed over to private sector, or, you know, we must contract the complete public sector section. Improving of the facilities to the laborers, empowering the laborers, giving them a lot of advantages, looking after their wages, looking after their welfare, looking after their growth and development. Improving facilities for laborers, talking to them, informing them, inviting them, all these things. So different welfare activities for laborers were also decided. Strategic locations of industries, which means where can we have these industries? Should all the industries be accumulated in a common place so that we save money in economies? So that, you know, all the connected industries, ancillary industries are nearby. So the location, the strategic location of these industries was also identified and was discussed. Encouragement to industries in backward areas, asking organization, businesses to set up their own industries in areas which are backward. So they get incentives, they'll be promoted, they'll be rewarded, they'll be given incentives. So all the businesses which will be opening in backward areas will get rewarded by the government. What happens in turn is that when someone goes and starts an industry in a rural or a backward area, for their own benefit, they end up developing the local infrastructure. They develop the roads, they develop the a transportation system, they develop a network, so they improve, they encourage employment. So all of these are the advantages of having industries coming into the backward areas. So you must have heard how Narendra Modi invited Ratan Tata for the production of Tata Nano in Gujarat, in one of the backward areas, and now that area is well developed, a lot of employment is being created, and there are only pluses for such kind of an activity. Concession from Monopolies Act. Monopoly means when one owner is only one business is taking advantage of the market. So there was a concession in Monopolies Act, which means people now no more can have monopolies. You should allow other people to come into the industry and make business. And facilities of import, you know, making import possible, allowing products from other countries to come into our country through the sea, through the air, through different modes. So let the products from other countries come, let us facilitate import and let us reduce import duties. So all these major changes were done in 1991 when the industrial policy resolution was done. So it was named, actually these changes were named as LPG, that is liberalization, privatization and globalization. So we'll study each word in totality, what liberalization means. So basically liberalization means to reduce unnecessary restrictions and controls on business units imposed by government. So you liberalize them, free them, give them opportunity to work according to their own pace. So when someone is liberated, he is given the freedom, more benefits will come. A lot of businesses, private businesses, they were made, they were given opportunity for availability of spare parts, raw materials. They could compete with foreign companies. So at that time in the year 1991, a lot of foreign companies were bringing some products which were of great demand in India. So Indian companies wanted to produce their own thing, but they could not manage to do that because of involvement of government. So when government told that, okay, no problems, you can produce your own goods and bring it in front of the foreign products. So there was a direct competition from the foreign companies, and we as Indian producers could enter our market and make good profit and compete with the foreign companies. So it's a great positive effect. Opportunity for additional investment of funds. Now, since we are liberalized, if I am a business organization, I have opportunity to raise funds from abroad. I can take money from people abroad. So that is not going to be a problem at all. My capital market increases in India. I get a lot of money from abroad. And higher opportunities for Indian exports. Now that I am producing global competitive products, since we are producing such high quality products, we can also send our products abroad for sale, and our Indian exports would benefit out of this. So these are the positive effects of liberalization. Because we got freedom, our companies, our organizations were given great freedom, we could work on this. There were some negative effects as well. There was some reduction in employment, because now we were able to get machineries, we were able to get raw materials pretty easily, and hence it was a difficult task for us to maintain certain employees. There was very less saving and investment, so we were majorly working on spending money. We were liberalized, so saving and investment got a bad hit. And we could face newer challenges in economy. So of course, when you bring such a huge change, you should be ready to face any kind of challenges. So this was one of the major outbursts of the 1991 economic policy, that is liberalization. Then we saw something called as privatization. Now, what is the meaning of privatization? Privatization means transfer of ownership and management of a public enterprise to a private enterprise. It's very simple. All the companies which were earlier managed by government, all the businesses which were, all the departments of businesses which were managed by government, like right now, you must be knowing that the railways industry is completely managed by Indian Railways. That's an Indian company. But there is a door opening now for a private player to come and participate in also in Indian Railways. Very recently, you must have also come to know that, or maybe people who stay in Bombay or Mumbai, they definitely know that we have Tata Power, we have Reliance also in gas sector or even in electricity sector. So Tata Power is a company, a private company which provides electricity to the residents of Mumbai, which means that a work which was earlier taken care by the government is now taken care by Tata, right? So with privatization, there was improvement in efficiency. Good companies started taking the responsibility. Productivity increased. There was all good things happening. There was proper management because, in public companies, people were not interested. Profits were maximized. There were profits, but it was increased. Resources were utilized very well. Competition was increased. And whatever manpower we had was used very effectively, very smartly, and because of the privatization. So we had quality manpower before also when it was a public organization, but since now it is turned out into a privatization, we could use manpower in a much better manner. So there were some, these were the advantages that we had because of privatization. The efficiency and productivity improved. We had competitive space of management. We could make more profit. We could make use of more resources. Though competition increased for better, we could also use manpower in a better manner. And finally, we have something called as globalization. So globalization means expansion of existing businesses, Indian businesses, globally, and giving up the consideration of regional or national boundaries for business expansion. So when you have a company who is willing to go abroad and sell their products, that is the meaning of the term globalization. So there were some positive and some negative effects. Better and faster industrialization. More and more companies came up. They wanted to go abroad, sell their products abroad. More capital flowed in, more money came in. Production facilities throughout the world increased because of a company who is in India is available globally. Standard of living started improving. People started to make money and they started living in a better manner. And technology started coming in our in a country because we were going abroad and we were seeing what different technologies are being used by the world, and we could bring it back here in the country. There were some negative effects of globalization. Again, labor problem happened because our companies are going abroad, so our labor is not getting employed. They are not getting the jobs. Natural resources, whatever we are producing here, is not being used in our country. It is going abroad. It's going out of our country. So again, that's a big problem. And domestic industry is facing a problem because we are selling products outside. We are making money outside. So we are not growing our own country. So these could be some negative effects of globalization. But in totality, this was a brave step. This was a great step towards growth and development of our country. So industrial development in India actually happened in the year 1991 when these three concepts of LPG, that is liberalization, privatization, globalization, was introduced. Finally, we'll be talking about the recent trends in Indian industry. In recent trends, we are talking about the multinational companies. Since we have allowed multinational companies to set up base here, we've got companies all across the world, especially the car manufacturing companies. If you see, they have their own setups here. They manufacture here, build here, sell here. So it is all Make in India. Huge development, huge change that has happened, that we are allowing foreign companies to come here, set up base, build products here, and we end up taking taxes from them. Huge Indian multinationals. You have heard about Tata Motors, who is also the owner of Jaguar Land Rover. So Tata Motors is an Indian company who is globally renowned. Ran Baxi is another company. Dr. Reddy's Laboratories is another company. They produce their pharmaceutical companies. Then Asian Paints, again, is an Indian company, very famous abroad. Bharat Forge, very famous abroad. Infosys, extremely famous abroad. Because one of the recent trends is that we are getting a lot of foreign investments. People are interested in investing in our economy. They are trusting Indian economy. They are trusting that India will grow. Foreign trade agreements, we are having a lot of bilateral, unilateral. We are having multilateral agreements with different countries. Just recently, we had a bilateral agreement with Bangladesh, with Israel, we've been having such agreements since past, and all these are the recent developments in Indian industry. So with this, we come to the end of this chapter, and basically we come to the end of this subject altogether. I'll quickly run through what we have discussed in this particular chapter. We have seen what is industrial role of industry in the Indian economic development. We saw what are the challenges that Indian industry is facing regarding labor, regional imbalance, finance and technological. We studied about the 1991 industrial policy resolution. We learned about the three concepts, that is LPG. We learned about what is liberalization, privatization and globalization. And then finally, we saw the recent trends in Indian industry. So students, thank you so much for listening to me, for paying attention to what I covered during these sessions. With this, I end the subject lectures for all of you. If there are any doubts, you can get catch hold of me on my official email address. These are additionally my contact details. I would like to wish you all the best for your exams in the future. Thank you so much. This is Professor Yogesh Nagpal signing off. Thank you.